ordinary sound. And I don't know if I'm being foolish, don't know if I'm being wise, but it's something that I must believe in. And I stare when I look in your eyes, what is in here, in the whisper of the trees. In the thunder of the sea. And I don't know if I'm just dreaming, don't know if I feel sane, but it's something that I must believe in. And it's there when you call out my name.
As far as I'm concerned, sentiment is my forte. I hate science for life.
Yes.
Speaking of the science of life, have you got the cucumber sandwiches cut for me, Brad?
Here, sir.
I see from your book that last Thursday, when we were dining with Lord Shawn and Mr. Worthing, 8 bottles of champagne are entered as having been consumed.
Yes, sir. 8 bottles and a pint.
Why is it that at a bachelor's establishment the servants invariably drink the champagne? I asked merely for information, of course.
I attribute it to the superior quality of the wine, sir. I often observe that in a married household the wine is really of the first-rate brand.
Good heavens. Is marriage such a moralizer with that?
I believe it is a very pleasant state, sir. I've had very little experience in it, but the present, I've only been married once. And that was in consequence of a misunderstanding between myself and a young person.
I don't know that I care that much about your family life, mate.
No, sir, it's not a very interesting subject. I try to think it much myself.
That's perfectly natural, I'm sure. That will do, lady. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Lane's views on marriage seem somewhat lax. Really, if the low lords can't set us a good example, then what on earth is the use of them? They seem as a class who have absolutely no sense of moral responsibility.
Mr. Ernest Worthing?
Ah, how are you, my dear Ernest? What brings you into town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else should bring one anywhere?
Eating as usual, I say, Algy.
I believe it is customary in your society to take some slight refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
Oh, in the country.
What on earth do you do that?
Oh, well, one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It is excessively boring.
And who are these people you amuse?
Oh, neighbours. Neighbours.
God, I say it's in your part of Shropshire.
Oh, perfectly horrid. Never speak to one of them.
How immensely you must amuse them. I think that Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Eh? Shropshire? Yes, of course. Hello! Why are these cups? Why the cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young? Who is coming to tea?
Merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolyn.
Oh, how perfectly delightful.
Yes, that is all very well. But I'm afraid Aunt Augusta won't quite approve of your being here.
May I ask why?
My dear fellow, the way you flirt with Gwendolyn is perfectly disgraceful. It is almost as bad as the way Gwendolyn flirts with you.
I am in love with Gwendolyn. I have come up to town expressly to propose to her.
I thought you'd come down for pleasure. I thought that business.
Oh, how utterly unromantic you are.
There is nothing romantic in proposing. It is certainly a romantic thing to be in love, but there is nothing romantic about a definite proposal. Why, one may be accepted, one usually is, I believe, and then the excitement is all over. If I ever get married, I'll certainly try to forget the fact that romance is the key. Yes.
Yes. Well, divorce courts were specially invented for people whose views were so curiously constituted.
There is no speculating on that subject. Divorce is our main heaven. Please don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They were ordered especially for Aunt Augusta.
But you have been eating them all the time.
That's quite a different matter. She is my aunt. Here, have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is for Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn's bread and butter.
And very good bread and butter it is too.
My dear fellow, you need not eat as if you were going to eat at all. You behave as if you were married to her already. You are not married to her already, and I don't believe you ever will be.
What made you say that?
Well, in the first place, girls never marry the men they flirt with. Girls don't think it right.
Well, that is nonsense.
It isn't. It is a great truth. It accounts for the extraordinary number of bachelors wanting all over the place. In the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
My dear boy, Gwendolyn is my first cousin, and in order for you to marry her, you must first clear up the whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? I don't know anyone of the name Cecily.
Hand me that cigarette case Mr. Worthing left the last time he had here.
Yes. You mean to say you've had my cigarette case all this time? I wish to goodness you had let me know. I've been writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
Well, I wish you would, my dear boy. I appear to be more than ordinarily hard up.
But there's no point offering one now that the thing is found.
That is very mean of you, as I must say. However, it makes no matter, for now that I look upon the inscription inside, I find that the thing isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times. You've no right whatsoever to read what is inside a private cigarette case. It is very ungentlemanly to read what is in a private cigarette case.
Oh, it is absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should read and what one shouldn't. More than half of one's culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
Yes, I'm quite aware of the fact. But I don't propose to discuss one's culture. It isn't the sort of thing one should do in private. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is a present from someone under the name of Cecily. And you told me you don't know anyone of that name.
Well, if you must know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes, charming old lady she is too, lives at Tunbridge Wells. Just give it back to me, auntie!
Yes, but why does she call herself Little Cecily if she is your aunt and lives at Tunbridge Wells? From Little Cecily with her fondest love.
My dear boy, what is there in that? Some answer tall, some answer not tall. That is a matter that surely an aunt should be able to decipher herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be like your aunt. That is absurd. Give me back my cigarette case!
Yes, as long as your aunt will you her uncle. From little Cecily, with her fondest love, to her dear Uncle Jack. There is no objection, I admit, to an aunt being a small aunt. Why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, should call her own nephew her uncle, I can't quite make out. And besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It is Ernest.
It isn't Ernest. It is Jack.
You have always told me it was Ernest. I've introduced you to everyone as Ernest. You answered to the name of Ernest. You looked as if your name was Ernest. In fact, you're the most Ernest-looking person I ever saw in my life. It's perfectly ridiculous. You're saying that your name isn't Ernest. It's even on your card. Here is one. Mr. Ernest Worthing, before the Albany. I'll keep this as proof if ever you try to deny that fact to me, or to Gwendolyn, or to anybody else.
Well, my name is Ernest in town, and Jack in the country. And the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that still doesn't account for the fact that your small aunt Cecily, who lives at Tunbridge Wells, was her own nephew, aren't you? Come on, dear boy. You would much better have the whole thing out at once.
My dear boy, you talk as if you were a dentist. You are not a dentist. It is very vulgar to talk like a dentist when one isn't a dentist. It produces false impressions.
That is exactly what dentists always do. Now go on. Tell me everything. I may mention I have always suspected you of being a secret and confirmed Bunburyist, and I must say I'm quite sure of it now.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by a Bunburyist?
I'll reveal to you the meaning of that incomparable expression as soon as you reveal to me why you are Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce me my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now, produce your explanation and pray. Make it improbable.
My dear boy, there's nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it's perfectly ordinary. Old Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle from motive of respect that you could not possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You are not invited. I may tell you quite frankly that it is not in Shropshire.
I've bumbled all over Shropshire on two separate occasions. Now go on. Tell me why you were Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
My dear Algy, I don't think you'll be able to understand my real motives. You are hardly serious enough. When one is placed in the position of guardian, one has to adopt a high moral tone on all subjects. And as a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce much towards one's health or one's happiness, in order to get up to town, I have created a younger brother who goes by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany and gets into the most dreadful scrapes. That, my dear Algy, is the whole truth. Answer.
The truth is rarely pure and never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if it were either, and modern literature a complete impossibility.
But that wouldn't be at all a bad thing.
Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. Don't try it. You should leave that to the people who haven't been at university. They do so well in the daily papers. What you really are is a Bunburyist. I was quite right in saying you were a Bunburyist. You're one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know.
What do you mean?
You've invented a very useful younger brother in order that you may be able to come into the town whenever you like. I've invented a perfectly invaluable permanent invalid in order that I may be able to go into the country whenever I choose. Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. If it wasn't for his extraordinary bad health, for instance, I wouldn't be able to dine with you at Willis's tonight, for I've really been engaged with Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
I haven't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You're absurdly careless about sending out invitations. Nothing annoys someone so much as not receiving an invitation.
You had better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I have no intention of doing anything of the kind. To begin with, I dine there on Monday, and once a week is more than enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, Whenever I do dine there, I am always treated as a member of the family, and either sent up with no women at all, or two. In the third place, I know exactly who she will place me next to tonight. She will place me next to Mary Farquhar, who always flirts with her own husband across the dinner table. It is not very nice. In fact, it is not even decent, and that sort of thing is enormously on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands is perfectly scandalous. It is merely washing one's own clean linen in public. And besides, now that I know you to be a Bunburyist, I naturally want to talk to you about Bunbury. I want to tell you all the rules.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolyn accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I'll kill him in any case. Cecily is a little too interested in him. It is rather a bore. So, I'm going to get rid of my brother, and I suggest you do the same with Mr... with your invalid friend who has the absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury. And if you ever get married, which seems to me extremely problematic, you'll be very glad to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
If I marry Gwendolyn, and she's the only girl I ever saw in my life who I would marry, I certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. You don't seem to realise that in married life, three is company and two is none.
That, my dear boy, is the theory that has been propounding the French drama for the last 50 years.
Yes, and that a happy English home has proved in half the time.
For heaven's sake, don't try to be cynical. It is very easy to be cynical.
It is not easy to be anything nowadays. There is so much beastly competition about. Ah, that must be Aunt Augusta. Only relatives or creditors ever ring in that Bohemian manner. Now, if I get her out of the way for 10 minutes so you can propose to Gwendolyn, might I dine with you tonight at Willis's?
I suppose so, if you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about meals. It is so shallow of them.
Hey, Brack, no, miss.
Good afternoon, dear Archer. I hope you're behaving very well.
Very well, Aunt Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
I am always smart, am I not, Mr. Wiley?
You're quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I'm not that. That will leave no room for developments, and I intend to develop in many directions.
I'm sorry we were a little late, Doctor, but I was obliged to call on dear Lady Harbury. I'd not been there since her poor husband's death. I'd never saw a woman quite so altered. She looks quite the 20 years younger. And now I'll have one of those nice cups of tea and a cucumber sandwich, you promise me.
Certainly, Aunt Augusta.
Won't you come to tea, Gwendolyn?
Thanks, Mama. I'm quite comfortable where I am.
Good heavens! Lane, why are there new cucumber sandwiches? I ordered them specially.
There were no cucumbers in the market this morning, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even four.
Ready, my man. Well, do they? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I am greatly distressed, Aunt Augusta, about there being no cucumbers. Not even four. Ready, money.
It really makes no matter, Algernon. I had some comforts with Lady Hardwick, who seems to me to be living entirely in pleasure now.
I hear her hair is turned quite pale from grief.
The colour has changed from what course I, of course, cannot say. Thank you. I have quite a treat for you tonight, Algernon. I'm going to send you down with Mary Farquhar. She's such a nice woman.
Not an alien.
So attentive to her husband. It's delightful.
I'm afraid, Aunt Augusta, that I shall have to give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight, after all.
I hope not. It would put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he's accustomed to that.
It is a great bore, and I need hardly say a terrible disappointment to me. But the fact is, I have just had a telegram to say that my poor friend Bunbury is very ill again. They seem to think I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, I must say, Algernon, that I think it is high time that Mr. Bunbury made up his mind to whether he was going to live or die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd, nor do I in any way approve of the modern sympathy for invalids. I consider it morbid. Illness is hardly a thing to be encouraged at others. Health is the primary duty of life. I most hand that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take much notice, as far as any improvement in his end goes. But I would be awfully obliged if you to ask Mr. Bunbury, from me, to be kind enough not to have a relapse on Saturday, for I rely on you to arrange my music for me. One wants something that will encourage conversation, especially at the end of the season, when everyone has said whatever it is they have to say, which at any rate was probably not much.
I'll speak to Bunbury Aunt Augusta, if he is still conscious. And I think I can confirm that he'll be all right by Saturday. Of course, the music is a great difficulty. You see, if one plays good music, people don't listen. And if one plays bad music, people don't fall. But I'll run over the programme I've drawn out. You will kindly come into the next room with me for a moment.
That is awfully thoughtful of you, Algernon. I'm sure the programme will be delightful after a few explanations. French songs? I cannot possibly allow. People seem to think they're improper and look shocked, which is vulgar, or laugh, which is worse. A German song? A most thoroughly respectable language, and I believe so. Gwendolyn, you will accompany me.
Certainly, Mama.
Charming day has been, Miss Fairfax.
Pray, don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Working. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else, and that makes me so nervous.
I do mean something else.
Oh, I thought so. In fact, I'm never wrong.
And I would like to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary absence.
I would certainly advise you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back so suddenly into a room that I've often had to speak to her about.
Gwendolyn, ever since I met you, I have admired you more than any other girl I have ever met since I met you!
Yes. I am quite well aware of that. And I often wish that, in public at any rate, you had been more demonstrative. For me, you have always had an irresistible fascination. Even before I met you, I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals. And my ideal has always been to love someone of the name Ernest. There is something in that name that inspires one with absolute confidence. The moment Algernon first mentioned to me that he had a friend named Ernest, I knew I was destined to love you.
You really love me, Gwendolyn?
Oh, passionately!
Darling, you don't love me!
My own Ernest!
But you don't mean to say you couldn't love me if my name wasn't Ernest.
But your name is Ernest.
Yes, yes, I know it is. But suppose it was something else. Do you mean to say you couldn't love me then?
Now that is clearly a metaphysical speculation, and like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference to the actual facts of real life as we know them.
Well, personally, darling, to speak quite candidly, I don't really much like the name of Ernest. I don't think the name suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has music of its own. Oh, it produces vibrations.
Oh! Personally, darling, I think there are much, much nicer names. I think Jack a charming name.
Jack. No, there's no music in the name Jack. If it are your indeed, it does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. I've known several Jacks, and they all, without exception, were more than usually plain. And besides, Jack is a notorious domesticity for John, and I pity any woman who's married to a man named John. She may never be allowed to know the single moment's solitude of an entrancing pleasure. The only real safe name is Ernest.
Oh, Gwendolyn, I must get christened at once.
We must get married at once. There's no time to lose.
Married, Mr. Wiley.
Well, surely, you know that I love you, and you led me to believe, Miss Fairfax, that you are not absolutely indifferent to me.
I adore you, Mr. Wiley, but you haven't proposed to me yet. Nothing has been said at all about marriage. The subject has not even been touched upon.
may I propose to you now?
I think it would be an admirable opportunity. And to spare you any disappointments, I think it is only quite fair to tell you frankly beforehand that I am fully determined to accept you.
Gwendolyn!
Yes, Mr. Wiley, what have you got to say to me?
You know what I've got to say to you.
Yes, but you don't say it.
Gwendolyn, will you marry me?
Of course I will, darling! How long have you been about it? I'm afraid you've had very little experience in how to propose.
Oh, my own one, I have never loved anyone in the world but you.
Yes, but men often propose for practice. I know that from the church, that's all my girlfriends tell me so. What wonderful new eyes you have, Ernest. They are quite frightful. I hope you will always look at me like that, especially when other people are present.
Mr. Worthy! Rise, sir! From that semi-recumbent posture! It is most indecorous.
Ma, I was begging to retire. This is no place for me. And besides, Mr. Quirton has not quite finished yet.
Finished what, may I ask?
Sorry. I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthy, Mama.
Pardon me. But you are not engaged to anybody. When you do become engaged to someone, I or your father, health permitting, will inform you of the fact. An engagement should come on a young girl as a surprise, pleasant or unpleasant, as the case may be. It is hardly a matter that she should be allowed to arrange for herself. Now, Mr. Worthy, I have got a few questions to put to you. Whilst I'm making these inquiries, you and Gwendolyn will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama!
In the carriage, Gwendolyn.
Gwendolyn!
The carriage! You may take a seat, Mr. Worthy.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell. I prefer standing.
I feel bound to tell you that you are not on my list of eligible young men. Though I have the same list as the dear Duchess of Bolton. We work together, in fact. However, I am more than willing to enter your name, should your answer be what a truly affectionate mother requires. Do you smoke?
Well, yes. I must admit I do smoke.
I'm glad to hear it. A man should always have an occupation of some kind. There are far too many idle men in London. How old are you?
29.
Oh, a very good age to be married at. In fact, if a man desires to get married, I believe that he should either know everything or nothing. Which do you
I know nothing, Lady Bracknell.
I'm glad to hear it. I do not approve of anything that tampers with the natural ignorance. Ignorance is like an exotic fruit. Touch it, and the bloom is gone. The whole theory of modern education is radically unsound. Fortunately, in England, at any rate, education produces no effect whatsoever. If it did, well, it would probably prove to be a serious danger to upper classes, and probably it acts of advancing Grosvenor Square. What is your income?
Between 7,000 and 8,000 a year.
In land or investments?
Oh, investments chiefly.
That is satisfactory. What between the duties expected of one during one's lifetime and those exacted from one after one's death, land has ceased to be either a pleasure or a profit. It gives one position, but prevents one from holding it up.
Well, I have a country house with some land, of course. Attached to it about 1,500 acres, I believe, but I don't depend on that for any real income. In fact, as far as I can make out, the poachers are the only people who make anything of it.
A country house? How many bedrooms has it got? That point would clear up afterwards. Now to my... what are your politics?
Oh, I am a coalitionist.
They count as Tories. They, divers, or come in the evening at any rate. Now to minor matters. Are your parents living?
I'm afraid I have lost both my parents.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthy, may be regarded as misfortune, but to lose them both, that just looks like carelessness. Who was your father? He was evidently a man of some wealth. Was he born in what the radical papers call the purple of commerce, or did he fight through the ranks of aristocracy?
I'm afraid. I really don't know. The fact is, Lady Bracknell, I said that I have lost both my parents. It would be nearer to the truth to say that my parents seem to have lost me. I don't know who I am by birth. I was found.
Found?
Thomas Cardew, a man of a kind and charitable disposition, found me and gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a first-class ticket for Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a place in Sussex. It is a seaside resort.
Where did the charitable gentleman who had the first-class ticket for the seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
In a handbag! In a handbag! In a handbag?
Yes. A somewhat large, brown, leather handbag. With handles to it. An ordinary handbag, in fact.
In what locality did this Mr. James or Thomas Cardew come across this ordinary handbag?
In the cloakroom at Victoria Station. It was given to him in mistake for his own.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
Yes. The bride and the lion!
The lion is immaterial, Mr. Worthing. I must confess, I'm somewhat bewildered by what you've just told me. To be born, or at any rate, bred in a handbag, seems to me to show some contempt for the modern decencies of ordinary family life. That reminds me of the worst excesses of the French Revolution. And I assume you know what that important movement led to. As for the particular locality in which the handbag was found, a cloakroom at one of the larger railway stations in London, might serve to conceal some social indiscretion, has probably indeed been used for that purpose before today. However, it could hardly be regarded as an assured basis for a recognized position in high society.
May I ask you then, what you would advise me to do? I need hardly say I would do anything to ensure Gwendolyn's happiness.
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to try and make a definite effort to find some relatives and to produce. At any rate, one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
Well, I don't see how I could possibly do that. I can produce you the handbag at any moment. It is in my dressing room at home. I really think that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What is it to do with me? You could hardly imagine that I or Lord Bracknell would allow our only daughter, a girl brought up with the most utmost of care, to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel. Good morning, Mr. Worthing.
Good morning! And for goodness sake, don't get a ghastly tune out here! How idiotic you are!
Ha 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 ha
did not go off all right, old boy. You don't mean to say Gwendolyn refused you? I know, it is a way she has. She's always refusing people. I think it is most ill-natured of her.
Well, Gwendolyn is as right as a trivet. As far as she's concerned, we are engaged. Her mother, however, is quite unbearable. Never met such a gorgon. I don't really know what a gorgon is like. But I'm sure she is one. Anyway, she is a monster, without being a myth. Which is rather unfair. I'm sorry, Algy. I don't mean to talk about your aunt in that way before you.
My dear boy, I love hearing my relations abused. They're the only things that make me put up with them at all. Relations are simply a tedious pack of people who have not the remotest knowledge of how to live, nor the smallest instinct about when to die.
That is nonsense.
It isn't.
Well, I won't argue about the matter. You always want to argue about things.
That is exactly what things were originally made for.
Upon my word, if I thought that, I'd shoot myself. You don't think there's any chance of Gwendolyn becoming like her mother in about 150 years?
All women become like their mothers. That is their tragedy. No man does. That's his.
Is that clever?
It's perfectly phrased and quite as true as any observation in civilized life should be.
I'm sick to death of cleverness. Everybody's clever nowadays. You can't go anywhere without meeting clever people. It's becoming an absolute public nuisance. I wish to goodness we had a few fools left.
We have.
Well, I would certainly like to meet them. What are they talking about?
The fools? Oh, about the clever people, of course.
What fools?
Have you told Gwendolyn yet the truth about your being Earnest in town and Jack of the Country?
My dear boy, the truth is not the thing that one tells to a nice, sweet, refined girl like Gwendolyn. What extraordinary ideas you have about the way to behave to a woman.
The only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her, if she is pretty, and to someone else if she is plain.
That is nonsense.
What about your brother? What about the proof that it earned it?
Oh, by the end of the week, I shall have got rid of him. I'll say he died in Paris of apoplexy. Lots of people die of apoplexy quite suddenly, don't they?
Yes, but it's hereditary, my dear fellow. It's the sort of thing that runs in families.
Ah.
You would much better say a severe chill.
And you are quite sure a severe chill is not hereditary?
Of course it is.
Very well then. My poor brother Ernest is carried off suddenly in Paris by a severe chill. That gets rid of him.
But I thought you said that Miss Cardew was a little too interested in your poor brother Ernest. Won't she feel his loss a good deal?
Oh, that is all right. Cecily is not a silly, romantic girl. She has a capital appetite, goes long walks, and pays no attention at all to her lessons.
I would very much like to see Cecily.
I will take very good care you'll never do. She is excessively pretty and only just 18.
Have you told Gwendolyn yet that you have an excessively pretty ward who is only just 18?
Oh, one doesn't blurt these things out to people. Cecily and Gwendolyn are sure to be extremely great friends. I bet you anything you like that half an hour after they have met, they will be calling each other sister.
Women only do that when they call each other a lot of other things. Now, my dear boy, if we want to get a good table at Willis's tonight, we really must go up and change. Do you know it is nearly 7?
Oh, it is always nearly 7.
I'm hungry.
I never knew you when you weren't.
What shall we do after dinner? Shall we go to a theatre?
Oh, no, I hate listening.
Let us go to a club.
Oh, no, I hate talking.
Well, we might trot around to the Empire then.
Oh, no. I hate looking at things. So silly.
Well, what shall we do?
Nothing.
It is awfully hard work doing nothing. However, I don't mind hard work when there is no definite object of any kind.
Miss Fairfax.
Oh, Gwendolyn, upon my word.
Algy, kindly turn your back for a moment. I have something very particular to say to Mr. Worthing.
Oh, really, Gwendolyn, I don't think I can allow that at all.
Algy, you always adopt a strictly immoral attitude towards life. You are not quite old enough to do that yet.
My own darling.
Ernest, we may never be married. From the expression of Mama's face, I fear we never shall. Few parents nowadays pay any regard to what their children have to say to them. The old-fashioned respect for the young is fast dying out. Whatever influence I ever had over Mama, I lost at the age of 3. But although she may prevent us from becoming married wife, and I may marry someone else and marry often, nothing that she could ever do could possibly alter my eternal devotion to you.
Oh, dear Gwendolyn.
The story of your romantic origin, as related to me by Mama, with unpleasing comments, has naturally stirred the deeper fibres of my nature. Your Christian name has an irresistible fascination, and the simplicity of your character makes you exquisitely incomprehensible to me. Your town address at Yardley I have. What is your address in the country?
The manor house?
Yes.
Wharton?
Mm-hmm.
Hertfordshire.
There is enough postal service, I suppose. It may be necessary to do something drastic, but that, of course, will require some serious consideration. I will communicate with you daily.
My own one.
How long do you remain in town?
Oh, till Monday.
Algy, you may turn around now.
Thanks. I've turned around already.
You may also ring the bell.
May I see you to your carriage, ma'am, darling?
Of course.
I will see Miss Fairfax out.
Yes,
sir. A glass of sherry, lady.
Yes.
Tomorrow, May, I'm going to Bunbury.
Yes, sir.
I shall not be back till Monday. You can put up my dress clothes, my smoking jacket, and all of the Bunbury suits.
Yes, sir.
I hope tomorrow will be a fine day, lady.
It never is, sir.
Poor Lane, you're a perfect pessimist.
I do my best to give satisfaction, sir.
There's a charming intellectual girl. The only girl I ever cared for in my entire life. What on earth are you so amused at?
Oh, I'm worried about my poor friend Bunbury, that's all.
If you're not careful, your friend Bunbury will get you into a serious scrape someday.
Oh, I love scrapes. They're the only things that are never serious.
That is nonsense. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Nobody ever does.
Cecily? Cecily! Surely such a utilitarian occupation as watering of flowers is rather more to the student than yours. Especially at a time when intellectual pleasures await you. Your German grammar is on the table. Pray finish page 15. We will repeat yesterday's lesson. But I don't like German! It is not at all a becoming language! And I know perfectly! I look rather plain after my German lesson. Tab, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. He laid particular stress on your German when he was leaving the town yesterday. Indeed, he always lays stress on your German when he is leaving for town.
Uncle Jack is so serious. Sometimes I think he's so serious that he cannot be quite well.
Your guardian enjoys the best of health. captain, if gravity of demeanour is one to be commended of one so comparatively young as he is. I know no man with a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that's why he looks a little bored when we three are together.
Cecily! I'm surprised at you. Mr. Wellington has many troubles in his life. Idle moments and triviality would be out of place in this conversation. You must remember his constant anxiety about the unfortunate young man, his brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would allow that unfortunate young man, his brother, to come down here sometime. We might have a good influence over him, Miss Brazil. I'm sure you certainly would. You know German and geology and things of that kind influence him out very much.
I do not think that even I could produce any effect on a character which, according to his own brother's admissions, irretrievably weak and vacillating. Indeed, I'm not sure I would desire to reclaim him. I'm not in favour of his modern name for turning bad and good people at a moment's notice. As a man, so shall you. You must put away your diary, Cecily. I really don't see why you should keep a diary at all.
I keep a diary in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I should probably forget all about them.
Memory, my dear Cecily, is a diary that we all carry about with us.
Yes, but it's usually chronicles, the things that have never happened or couldn't possibly have happened. I believe that memory is responsible for nearly all the three-volume novels that Moody sends us.
You will not speak slightly of the three-volume novels, Cecily. I wrote one myself in earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are! I hope it did not end happily. I don't like novels that end happily. They impress me so much.
The good end happily and the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means.
I suppose so. But it seems very unfair. And was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript, unfortunately, was abandoned. I use the word in a sense of rot or mislaid. Have you worked out? Speculations are profitless.
But I see Dr. Chasuble coming up through the garden.
Dr. Chasuble! It is indeed a pleasure.
And how are we this morning, Miss Prism? You are, I trust, well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do us so much good to take a short stroll in the park with you, Dr. Chasuble.
Cecily, I've not mentioned anything about a headache.
No, I know that, dear Miss Prism, but I felt instinctively that you had a headache. Indeed, I was thinking about that and not about my German lesson when the rector came in.
Oh, I hope, Cecily, you're not inattentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang up on her lips. I spoke metaphorically. Please. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from town yet.
We do not expect him till Monday afternoon.
Ah, yes. He's usually, I suspect, it's Sunday in London. He's not one of those whose sole aim is enjoyment. As by all accounts, that unfortunate young man's brother seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name is Letitia, Doctor!
A classical illusion, really drawn from pagan authors. I shall see you both, no doubt, at evensong.
I think, dear Doctor, I will have a stroll with you. I find I have a headache after all, and a walk might be some good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We might go as far as the schools and back.
That would be delightful. Cecily, you'll finish your chapter on Fall of the Nuclear Pyramid. Somewhat too sensational. Even if the talent projects have a melodramatic side.
Horrid political economy! Horrid geography! Horrid German!
Our most known, earnest, nothing has just driven over from the station. He has brought his luggage with him.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, being called Algernon. Uncle Jack's brother! Did you tell him Uncle Jack was in town?
Yes, miss, he seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you've been prisoner in the garden. He said he was anxious to speak to you privately for a moment.
Tell Mr. Ernest Worthing to come out here and
I suppose I'd better talk to the housekeeper about a room for him.
Yes, miss!
And you, I see from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother, my cousin Ernest, my wicked cousin.
Oh, I'm not wicked at all, Cousin Cecily. You mustn't think that I'm wicked.
If you are not, then you have certainly been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you have not been pretending to be very wicked, being really good all the time. That would be hypocrisy!
Oh, of course, I've been rather reckless.
I'm glad to hear it.
Now you mention the subject, I have been very bad in my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that. It's been very pleasant.
It is much pleasanter being here with you.
I can't understand how you're here at all. Uncle Jack won't be back until Monday afternoon.
That is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to go off by the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I am anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but in London?
No, the appointment is in London.
Well, I know, of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement. But still, I think you'd better wait for Uncle Jack. I know he wants to talk to you about your emigrating.
My what?
You're emigrating! He's going to have to buy your outfit!
I certainly wouldn't let Jack buy my outfit. He has no taste in neckties at all.
I don't think you will require neckties. Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia!
Australia? I'd sooner die.
Well, they said at dinner on Wednesday night that you had to choose between this world, the next world, or Australia.
Oh well, the accounts I have read are Australia and the next world, not particularly encouraging. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
That is why I need you to reform me. You might make that your mission if you like, Cousin Cecily.
I'm afraid I have no time this afternoon.
Do you mind my reforming myself this afternoon?
It would be rather quizzical, but I think you should try.
I shall. I feel better already.
You're looking a little worse.
That's because I'm hungry.
How thoughtless of me! I should have remembered that when one is going to lead an entirely new life, one requires a regular and wholesome meal. Won't you come in?
Thanks. Might I have a bunghole first? I've hardly ever any appetite unless I have a bunghole first.
A merry El Chanel?
No, I'd sooner have a rose.
Why?
Because you were like a rose, Cousin Cecily.
I don't think it can be quite right for you to talk to me like that. Miss Prism never says such things.
Miss Prism is a short-sighted old lady. You were the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snare.
They are a snare that every sensible man would like to be caught in.
Oh, I don't think I'd like to catch a sensible man. I should have known what to talk to him about. You are too much alone, dear daughter. You should get married. Listen to him, I can understand. A woman's friend? Never!
And you know, deserve some neologistic phrase. The precept as well as the practice of the primitive church was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church has not lasted up to the present day. And you do not seem to realize, dear doctor, that by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent temptation. Men should be more careful. This very celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
Oh, is a man that is attractive and married?
No married man is ever attractive except to his wife.
And often have you told not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual symptoms of the woman. Maturity can always be depended on. Rightness can be trusted. Young women are green.
Well, I've been talking about.
I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor was drawn from fruits. But where is Cecily?
Perhaps she follows us to the schools.
Mr. Worthing! This is indeed a surprise. He did not look to you for Monday afternoon.
Oh, I have returned sooner than I expected. Dr. Chasuble, I hope you are well.
You, Mr. Worthing. Just this garb on board, is that talk of some terrible calamity?
My brother!
More shameful debts and extravagance?
Still leading his life on pleasure.
Dead!
Your brother Ernest dead?
Quite dead!
What a lesson for him! I trust he will profit by it!
Mr. Worthing, I offer you my sincere condolence, if I please the consolation of knowing that you're the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
Poor Ernest. He had many faults, but it is a sad, sad blow.
Very sad indeed. Were you with him at the end?
No. He died abroad. In Paris, in fact. I had a telegram last night from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
What was the cause of death mentioned?
A severe chill, it seems.
Charity, dear Miss Griffin. Charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to drafts. Will the interment take place here?
But no. He seems to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
In Paris? I fear that hardly points to any very serious state of mind at the last. You would not have wished to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic picture next Sunday. My sermon on the meaning of the manner can be adapted to almost any occasion. Joyful, or in the present case, distressing. I have preached our holy celebrations, christenings, confirmation, days of humiliation, and festival days. The last time I delivered it, it was in the cathedral for a charity sermon on behalf of the society. For the prevention of discontent among the upper orders. The bishop who was present was much struck by some of the analogies I drew.
Ah, that reminds me. You mentioned christenings, I think, Dr. Chasuble.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure you know how to christen, all right? I mean, you are continually christening, aren't you?
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. I've often spoken to the poorer classes on the subject. But they don't seem to know what thrift is.
Is there any particular infant in whom you're interested in, Mr. Worthing? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, or whatever.
Oh, yes.
People who live in child pleasure usually are.
But it is not for any child, dear Doctor. I'm very fond of children. No. The christening would be for me, if you have nothing better to do.
But surely, Mr. Worthing, you've been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
Have any good doubts on the subject?
I certainly intend to have. Of course, I don't know if the thing would bother you in any way, or if you think I am a little too old now.
Oh, not at all. The sprinkling and indeed the immersion of idols is a perfectly canonical practice.
Immersion?
Oh. You need have an apprehension. Sprinkling is all that is necessary. Or indeed, I think advisable. Our weather is so changeable. But what hour would you like the ceremony to perform that?
Oh, I might trot round about 5 if that would suit you.
Oh, perfectly. In fact, I have a similar case of twins that occurred in the Upland villages on your own estate. Poor Jenkins the Carter, most hardworking man.
No! I don't want to be christened with other babies. It would be childish. Would 5:30 suit you?
Oh, admirably, admirably. Oh, and now, Mr. Worthing,
I will not intrude any longer into a house full of sorrow. I will merely beg you not to be too much bowed down by grief. What seems to us bitter trials are often lessons in disguise.
This seems to be a lesson of an extremely obvious kind. Uncle Jack! Oh, I am pleased to see you! But what horrid clothes you've got on! Do go and change them! Cicely!
My child!
What is the matter, Uncle Jack? You look happy! You don't think you have teeth! And I've got such a surprise for you! Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother!
Who?
Your brother Ernest! He arrived about half an hour ago!
What nonsense! I haven't got a brother.
Oh, don't say that. Now I remember he's behaved to you in the past. He is still your brother. You couldn't be so heartless into disowning him. I'll tell him to come out now. And you will shake hands with him, won't you?
He's not very exciting tidings.
After they've gone to be resigned to his loss, his sudden return seems to me peculiarly distressing.
In the dining room? I don't know what it all means. I think it's perfectly ridiculous. Good heavens!
Brother John, I've come down from town to tell you that I am very sorry for all the trouble I have caused you in the past, but that I intend to lead a better life in the future.
Oh, Jack, you are not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to take his hand. I think he's coming down here disgraceful. He knows perfectly well why.
Uncle Jack, do be nice. There's some good in everybody. Ernest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury. Well, he goes and is an offer. And surely there must be much good in one of his kind to an invalid. Only the pleasure of London.
Oh, he has been talking about Bunbury, has he?
Yes, Ernest has told me all about poor Mr. Bunbury and his terrible state of health.
Bunbury? Well, I won't have him talk to you about Bunbury or about anything else. It's enough to drive one perfectly frantic.
Of course, I admit the faults are all on my side, but I must say that I find Brother John's coldness towards me peculiarly painful. I expected a more enthusiastic welcome, seeing as this is the first time I've been here.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake hands with Ernest, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never. Never. Never.
Well, this is the last time I shall ever do it.
Pleasant, is it not, to see the perfect reconciliation? I think we shall leave the trip with us together.
Cecily, you will come with us. Certainly. My little task of reconciliation is over.
You have done a beautiful action today, dear Jack.
We must not be premature in our judgments. I feel very happy.
Algy, you young scoundrel. You have got to leave. I don't allow Bunbury here.
Ah, poor Mr. Ernest Rogers! And the new next year also! I suppose that is all, eh?
What?
Mr. Ernest Robinson! I'm a partner! I'll put them in the new next to your own!
His luggage?
Yes, sir! Three portmanteaus! And racing keys! Two hat boxes! And a one washing basket!
I shall only be able to stay for a week this time.
Merriman, order the dog cart at once. Mr. Worthy,
has suddenly been called back to town.
Your son!
What a fearful lie you are, Jack. I haven't been called back to town at all.
Yes, you have.
I can't hear anyone call me.
Your duty as a gentleman calls you back.
My duty as a gentleman has never interfered with my pleasures in the smallest degree.
I can quite understand that.
Well, Cecily is a darling.
You are not to talk of this card you like that. I don't like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. You look perfectly ridiculous in them. Why on earth did you go up and change? It is perfectly childish to be in deep mourning for a man who is actually staying with them in their house for a week as a guest. I call it grotesque.
You are not staying with me as a guest or as anything else. You have got to leave by the 4:05 train.
I certainly shan't leave you as long as you're in deep mourning. It would be most unfriendly. You would stay with me, I suppose. I would find it very unfriendly if you didn't.
Well, will you go if I change my clothes?
Yes. If you were not too long. I've never known anyone take so long to dress, and with such little result.
Well, that is better than being always overdressed, as you are.
If I'm occasionally a little overdressed, I make up for it by always being immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous. Your conduct an outrage, and your presence in my garden utterly absurd. However, you have got to leave by the 4:05, and I hope you have a pleasant journey home. This Bunbury, as you call it, has not been a great success for you.
I think it has been a great success. I'm in love with Cecily, and that is everything. But I must see her before I go, and make arrangements for another Bunbury. Ah, there she is. To order the dog cart for me.
Oh, is he going to take you on a nice drive?
He's going to send me away.
Send me on the cart?
I'm afraid so. It is a very painful parting.
It is always painful to part from people who you've known for such a brief space of time. The absence of all friends can be due with vacuity. But even a momentary separation from anyone who's just been introduced is almost unbearable.
Thank you.
The door code is at the door, sir.
You can wait for only 5 minutes.
Yes, miss.
I hope, Cecily, I shall not offend you if I state quite frankly and openly that you seem to me to be in every way the visible personification of absolute perfection.
I think your frankness does you great credit. If you will allow me, I will copy the mark into my diary.
Would you really keep a diary? I'd give everything to look at it, may I?
Oh no, you see, it is simply a young girl's record of her own thoughts and impressions, and consequently for publication, when it appears in volume 4. I hope you will order a copy. But pray, Ernest, don't stop. I delight in down taking from dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. You can go on. I'm quite ready for more. Oh, don't cough, Ernest. When one is dictated, one should speak fluently. I'm not cough. Besides, I don't know how to spell a cough.
Cecily? Ever since I first looked upon your wonderful and incomparable beauty, I dare to love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly.
I don't think you should tell me that you love me. Wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly. Hopelessly doesn't seem to make much sense, does it?
Cecily.
The door card is waiting, sir!
Tell it to come round next week, at the same hour.
Yes, sir!
Uncle Jack would be very much enough if he knew you were staying till next week at the same hour.
Oh, I don't care about Jack. I don't care about anybody in the whole world but you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
You silly boy, of course! Why, we've been engaged for the last 3 months!
The last 3 months?
Yes, it would be exactly 3 months on Thursday!
But when did we become engaged?
Well, ever since Uncle Jack confessed to us that he had a younger brother who was very wicked and bad. You, of course, have formed the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. And, of course, a man who is much talked about is always very attractive. One feels there must be something in him. And after all, I dare say it was foolish of him when I fell in love with you.
Darling. But when was the engagement actually settled?
On the 14th of February last, worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence, I determined to end the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you under the dear old tree here. The next day, I bought this little ring in your name. And this bangle was the true love's nut I've promised you always to wear.
Did I give you this? It's very pretty, isn't it?
Yes, you've wonderfully good taste, Ernest. It's the excuse I've given you for leading such a bad life. And here is the box in which I keep all your dear letters.
My letters? But my own sweet Cecily, I've never written you any letters.
You need only to remind me of that. I remember only too well that I was forced to write your letters for you. I always wrote 3 times a week, and sometimes often on.
Oh, do let me read them, Cecily.
Oh, I couldn't possibly. They'd make you sound far too conceited. The 3 you wrote me after I'd broken off the engagement are so beautiful and so badly spelled that even now I can hardly read them without crying a little.
But was our engagement ever broken off?
On the 22nd of last month, you can see the entry for that. Today I broke off my engagement for words. I feel it was better to do so. The weather still continues showing.
Why on earth did you break it off? What have I done? I've done nothing at all. Cecily, I'm very much hurt indeed to hear that you broke it off. Particularly when the weather was so charming.
You could have hardly been a really serious occasion. If it had a pretty broke off at least once. But I forgave you for the week as well.
What a perfect angel you are, Cecily.
Oh, you dear romantic boy. I hope your hair curls naturally, does it?
Yes, darling. With a little help from others.
I'm so glad.
We'll never break off our engagement again, Cecily.
I don't think I could now that I've actually met you. Besides, there is the question of your name.
Yes, of course.
You must not laugh at me, darling, but it has always been a girlish dream of mine to love someone whose name on earth is. The voice alone inspires one with absolute confidence. I've been the only married woman whose husband is not called Ernest.
But my dear child, do you mean to say you could not love me if I had another name?
But what name?
Oh, any name you like. Algernon, for instance.
Well, I'd like the name Algernon.
My own dear, sweet, loving little darling, I really can't see why I should object to the name of Algernon. It is a very good name. In fact, it is rather an aristocratic name. Half of the chaps are going to the bankruptcy court called Algernon. But seriously, Cecily, if my name was Algy, wouldn't you love me?
I might respect you, Ernest. I might admire your character. But I fear that I should not be able to give you my undivided attention.
Cecily, your lector here is, I suppose, thoroughly experienced in the practice of all the rites and ceremonials of the church.
Oh, yes! Dr. Chasuble is a most learned man. He has never written a single book in his life, so you can imagine how much he knows.
I must see him at once at a most important christening. I mean on most important business.
Oh.
I shall be away for more than half an hour.
Considering that we have been engaged since February the 14th, and that I only met you today, I think it would be rather hard of you to leave me at such a long period as half an hour. Could you not make it convenient?
I'll be back in no time.
Oh, the precious boy is... I like his hair so much. I must enter his proposal in my diary.
A Miss Fairfax has called to see Mr. Worthing on very important business, Miss Fairfax states.
Is Mr. Worthing not in his library?
Mr. Worthing went over in the direction of the rectory some time ago.
Pray ask the lady to come out here. Mr. Worthing is sure to be back soon. I'm preparing some tea.
Yes, miss!
Miss Fairfax, I suppose one of the Abdin ladies are associated with Uncle Jack and some of his philanthropic work in London. I don't like women who are interested in philanthropic work. You can so find them there.
Miss Fairfax!
Pray let me introduce myself to you. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew, what a very sweet name. Something tells me that we are going to be great friends. I like boarding more than I can say, and my first impressions of you are never wrong.
How nice of you to like me so much after we have known each other for such a comparatively short time. Pray sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will always call me Gregory, won't you?
If you wish.
Then that is all quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
Perhaps this might be a favourable opportunity by mentioning who I am. My father is Lord Bracknell. You have never heard of Papa, I suppose.
I don't think so.
Outside of the family circle, Papa, I'm glad to say, is entirely unknown. I think that is quite as he should be. The home seems to me to be the proper sphere for the man. And certainly, once a man begins to neglect his domestic duties, he becomes painfully effeminate, does he not? I don't like that. It makes men so very attractive. Cecily, Mama, whose views and education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be extremely short-sighted. It's part of her system. So, do you mind if I look at you through my glasses?
Oh, not no, Gwendolyn. Quite fond of being looked at.
You are here in a short visit, I suppose?
Oh no, I live here!
Really? Your mother, no doubt, or some other female relative of advanced years resides here also.
Oh no, I have no mother, nor in fact any relations.
Indeed.
My guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, have the arduous task of looking after me.
Guardian?
Yes, I'm Mr. Worthing's ward.
Oh. It's strange. He never mentioned to me that he had a ward. How secretive. It grows more interesting hourly. However, I'm not sure that the news inspires me with feelings of mixed delight. I'm very fond of you, Cecily. I've liked you ever since I met you. However, I'm bound to point out that now that I'm aware that you're Mr. Worthing's ward, I cannot help expressing a wish you were just a little older than you seem to be. And not so quite very alluring in appearance. In fact, if I may speak candidly...
Pray do. I think whenever one has anything unpleasant to say, one should always be quite candid.
Well, to speak with perfect candor, Cecily, I wish that you were fully 42 and more than usually paid for your age. Ernest has a strong, upright nature. He is the very soul of truth and honour. Disloyalty would be as impossible to him as deception. But even men of the noblest possible moral character are extremely susceptible to physical charms of others. Modern, no less than ancient history, provides us with many most painful examples of what I refer to. It is not so, in fact, history would be quite agreeable.
I beg your pardon, William, but did you say Ernest?
Yes.
But it's not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is my guardian. It is his elder brother.
Ernest never mentioned to me that he had a brother.
I'm sorry to say, but they have not been on good terms for a long time.
That accounts for it. And now that I come to think of it, I've never heard any man mention his brother. The subject seems distasteful to most men. And you have lifted a load from my mind, Cecily. I was growing more so anxious. It would have been terrible if any cloud had come across a friendship like ours would be melting. However, you are quite sure that it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be his. There is no reason why I should make it a secret to you. Our little country newspaper is sure to chronicle the fact next week. Mr. Ernest Worthing and I are engaged to be married! My darling Cecily! There must be some slight error! Mr. Ernest Worthing is engaged to be married to me. The announcement will appear in the Morning Post on Saturday, the notice. You must be under some misconception. Ernest proposed to me exactly 10 minutes ago. It is very curious, for he asked me to be his wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. If you care to verify the incident, pray do so. I never travel without my diary. One should always have something sensational to read on the train. I am so sorry, dear Cecily, if it is any disappointment to you, but I'm afraid that I have a prior claim. It would distress me more than I can tell you, dear Gwendolyn, if it has caused you any mental or physical anguish. But I want to point out that since Ernest proposed to you, he has clearly changed his mind. If the poor fellow has been entrapped into any foolish promise, I shall consider it my duty to rescue him at once. And with a firm hand. Whatever unfortunate entanglement my dear boy may have got into, I will never reproach him of it when we are married. Do you allude to me, Miss Cardinal, as an entanglement? You are presumptuous. On an occasion of this kind, it becomes more than a moral duty to speak one's mind. It becomes a pleasure. Do you suggest, Miss Fairfax, that I entrapped Ernest into an engagement? How dare you! This is no time for wearing the shallow mask of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade! I'm quite glad to say that I haven't seen a spade, Miss Cardew. It's quite clear that our social spheres have been widely different.
Shall I make tea here as usual, miss?
Yes, as usual. Are there many interesting walks in the vicinity, Miss Cardew?
Oh, yes, a great many. From one at the top of the hills. Quite close. One can see five counties.
Five counties? I don't think I should like that. I hate crowds.
I suppose that's why you live in the town.
Quite a well-kept garden, Miss Cardew.
So glad you like it, Miss Fairfax.
I had no idea that there were flowers in the country.
Oh, yes, flowers are quite common here. As the people are in London.
Personally, I cannot understand how anybody manages to exist in the country, if anybody is anybody does. The country always bores me to death.
May I offer you some tea, Miss Fairfax?
Thank you. Detestable girl, but I require tea.
Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar isn't fashionable anymore.
Oh.
Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best households nowadays. How sad to miss Fairfax.
Your miss, there's your key. There's your key.
You have the light to use lumps of sugar, and then I asked most distinctly for bread and butter. You have given me cake. I am known for the gentleness of my disposition and the extraordinary sweetness of my nature. But I warn you, Miss Cardew, you may go too far.
To save my poor, innocent, trusting boy from the machinations of any other girl, there are no lengths to which I would not go.
From the moment I saw you, I distrusted you. I felt that you were false and deceitful. I'm never deceived in such things. My first impressions of people are invariably right.
It seems to me, Miss Fairfax, that I'm trespassing in your valuable time. No doubt you have any other cause for similar character to make in the neighbourhood.
Ernest. My own Ernest. No, a moment. May I ask if you are engaged to marry to this young lady?
What? To dear little Cecily? Of course not. What could have put such an idea into your pretty little head?
Thank you. You may.
I knew there must be some misunderstanding, Miss Fairfax. The gentleman whose arm is a present around your waist is my guardian, Mr. John Worthing.
I beg your pardon.
This is Uncle Jack.
Jack! Oh!
Here is Ernest!
My own bond.
A moment, Ernest. May I ask you, are you engaged to be married to this young lady?
What young lady? Oh, good heavens, Gwendolyn!
Yes, to good heavens, Gwendolyn. I mean Gwendolyn.
Of course not. What could have put such a silly idea into your pretty little head?
Thank you. You may.
I felt there was some size around the sergeant. The gentleman who is currently embracing me is my cousin, Mr. Algernon Moncrieff. Algernon Moncrieff! Oh! Oh, you really call Algernon!
Oh, I cannot deny it.
Oh. Is your name really Jack?
I could deny it if I liked. I could deny anything if I liked. But my name is Jack. It has been Jack. 4 years.
A gross deception has been practiced on both of us.
My poor wounded Cecily.
My sweet from Gwendolyn Kilcoyne's sister, will you not? I will be just one question that will be allowed to ask my guardian.
An admirable idea. Mr. Worthing, there is just one question I would like to be permitted to put to you. Where is your brother Ernest? We are both engaged to be married to your brother Ernest, so it is a matter of some importance to us to know where your brother Ernest is at present.
Gwendolyn? Cecily? It's very painful for me to be forced to speak the truth. It's the first time I have ever been in duped for such a position, and I am very inexperienced. However, I may tell you quite frankly,
that I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all. I have never had a brother, and I certainly don't intend on having a brother in the future.
No brother at all?
No.
Had you never a brother of any kind?
Never, not even of any kind.
I'm afraid, Cecily, that neither of us is engaged to be married to anyone.
This is not a very pleasant position to a young girl to suddenly find herself in, is it?
No. Let us go into the house. They will hardly dare to find the bodies in there.
No. Men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This ghastly state of things is what you would call Bunburying, I suppose.
Yes. And a perfectly wonderful Bunbury it is as well. One of the best Bunburys I've ever had in my life.
Well, you've no right whatsoever to Bunbury here.
That is absurd. One has a right to Bunbury anywhere one chooses. Every serious Bunbury is known that.
Serious Bunburys? Good heavens!
Well, one must be serious about something if one wants to have any enjoyment in life. I happen to be serious about Bunburying. What on earth you are serious about, I haven't got the remotest idea. About everything, I should fancy. You have such an absolutely trivial nature.
Well, the only small satisfaction I have in the whole of this wretched business is that your friend Bunbury is quite exploded. You will be able to run down to the country quite so often as you used to, dear boy. And a very good thing, too.
Your brother is looking a little off-colour, isn't he, dear Jack? You won't be able to disappear to London quite so frequently as your wicked custom was, and not a bad thing, either.
I must say, your taking in a sweet, simple, innocent girl like Cecily is quite inexcusable. Say nothing of the fact that she is my ward!
Well, I can find no possible offence at all for your deceiving a brilliant, clever, thoroughly experienced young lady like Miss Fairfax, to say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin.
I wanted to be engaged to Gwendolyn. That is all. I love her!
Well, I merely wanted to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
There is certainly no chance of you marrying Miss Carson.
There is not much likelihood, Jack, of you and Miss Fairfax ever being united.
Well, that is no business of yours.
If it was my business, I wouldn't talk about it. It is very vulgar to talk about one's business. Only people like stockbrokers do that, and then they make dinner parties.
How you can sit there, calmly eating muffins, whilst we're in this horrible trouble, I can't make out. You seem to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. The butter would probably get in my cuffs. One must always eat muffins quite calmly. It is the only way to eat them.
I say, it's perfectly heartless you eating muffins at all under the circumstances.
When I'm in trouble, eating is the only thing that consoles me. Indeed, when I'm in really great trouble, as anyone who knows me intimately will tell you, I accept nothing but food and drink. At the present, I'm eating because I'm unhappy. And besides, I'm particularly fond of muffins.
Well, there is no reason why I should eat them at all in that greedy way.
I wish you would have tea cake instead. I do not tea cake.
Oh, good heavens! I suppose a man may eat his own muffins in his own garden!
But you just told me it was perfectly harmless to eat muffins.
I say, it was perfectly harmless of you under the circumstances. That! I said,
blame me. But the coffins are the same.
Algie! I wish to goodness you would go.
You can't possibly ask me to go without having my dinner. That is absurd. No one ever goes without having their dinner. Except for vegetarians and people like that. And besides, I've just made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 5:45 under the name of Ernest.
My dear boy, the sooner you get off that nonsense, the better. I made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble this morning to rechristen myself at 5:30, and I naturally will take the name of Ernest. Gwendolyn would wish it. We can't both be named Ernest. That is absurd. Besides, I have a perfect right to rechristen if I like. I find it extremely probable I never was, and so does Dr. Chasuble. It is entirely different in your case. You have been christened already.
Yes. But I have not been christened for years.
Yet if you have been christened, that is the vital thing.
Why so? So I know my constitution can stand it. If you're not quite so sure about your ever being christened, I must say I find it very dangerous you're venturing in on it now. It might make you very unwell. Can't have forgotten that someone very closely connected with you was carried off this week in Paris by a severe ship.
Yes. But you said yourself that a severe chill was not hereditary.
It used to be, I know, but I dare say it is now. Science is always making wonderful improvements in these things.
Oh, that is nonsense. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Oh, Jack, you're at the muffins again. I wish you wouldn't. There are only two left. I told you I was particularly fond of muffins.
But I hate tea cake.
Why on earth, then, would you allow tea cake to be served up to your guests? What ideas you have on hospitality!
Algernon! I've already told you. I don't want you here. Why don't you go?
Well, I haven't quite finished my tea yet. Besides, there is still one muffin left.
Get the food.
Yes, sir.
The fact that they did not at once swallow us into the house, as anyone else would have done, seems to me to show that they have some sense of shame left.
They have been eating muffins. That looks like repentance.
They don't seem to notice at all. Couldn't you copy?
But I don't have a copy.
They're looking at us. What a country. They're approaching. That's very forward of them.
Let us preserve a dignified silence.
Certainly.
It's the only thing that we can do now.
This dignified silence seems to produce a most unpleasant effect.
A most distasteful one.
But we will not be the first to speak. Certainly not. Mr. Worthing! I have something very particular to say to you. Much depends on your reply. Quickly, your common sense is invaluable.
Mr. Moncrieff, kindly answer me the following question. Why did you pretend to be my guardian's brother?
In order that I might have an opportunity of meeting you.
That certainly seems a satisfactory explanation.
Yes, dear, you can believe it.
That does not affect the wonderful beauty of his answer.
True. I had forgotten. In matters of great importance, style, not sincerity, is the vital thing. Mr. Worthing, what explanation can you off to me for pretending to have a brother? Was it in order that you might have the opportunity of coming up to town to see me as often as possible?
Can you doubt it, Miss Fairfax?
I have the greatest doubts on the subject, but I intend to crush them. This is not the time for German scepticism. Their explanations appear to be quite satisfactory, especially Mr. Worthing's. That seems to have the stamp of truth upon it.
I am more than content with what Mr. Moncrieff said. His voice alone inspires one with absolute credulity.
Then you think we should forgive them?
Yes!
Yes!
I mean, no!
True, I had forgotten. There are principles at stake that one cannot surrender. But each of us should tell them. The task is not a pleasant one.
Can we both not speak at the same time?
An excellent idea! I nearly always speak at the same time as others. Will you take the time for me?
Certainly.
Your Christian names are still an insuperable barrier. That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all? But we are going to be christened this afternoon.
No. For me, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
I am.
To please me, you are ready to face this pitiful ordeal.
I am.
Oh, how absurd to talk of the equality of the sexes. Where men are concerned in questions of self-sacrifice, they are infinitely beyond us.
We are.
There are moments of physical courage in which we women know absolutely nothing.
Oh, darling.
Darling.
Good heavens! Gwendolyn! What does this mean?
Merely that I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Come here. Sit down. Sit down immediately. Hesitation of any kind is a sign of mental decay in the young. Of physical weakness in the old. Apprised, sir. By my daughter's sudden flight. By her trusty maid, whose confidence I purchased by the means of a small coin. I followed her at once by luggage tray. Her unhappy father is, I am glad to say, under the impression that he is attending a more than usually lengthy lecture by the University Extension Scheme on the influence on a permanent income on thought. I do not propose to undeceive him. In fact, I have never undeceived him on any question. I would consider it wrong. However, you will clearly understand that all communication between yourself and my daughter must cease immediately from this moment. On this point, as indeed on all points, I am firm.
I am engaged to be married to Gwendolyn, Lady Bracknell.
You are nothing of the kind, sir. Now as regards Algernon. Algernon!
Yes, Aunt Augusta.
May I ask if it is in this house that your invalid friend Bunbury resides?
But Bunbury? Oh, no, no, Bunbury doesn't live here. But Bunbury is somewhere else at present. In fact, Bunbury's dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die? That must have been extremely sudden.
Oh, I killed Bunbury off this afternoon. I mean, poor Bunbury died this afternoon.
What did he die of?
Bunbury? Oh, he was quite exploded.
Exploded? Was he the victim of a revolutionary outrage? I had no idea that Mr. Bunbury was interested in social legislation. If so, he's well punished for his morbidity.
My dear Aunt Augusta, I mean he was found out.
The doctors found out that he couldn't live. That is what I mean. Sir Bunbury died.
He seemed to have had a great confidence in the opinion of his physician. But I'm glad that he made up his mind at the last for some definite course of action. Mr. Worthy, now that we've got rid of this Mr. Bunbury, may I ask who that young person is whose hand my nephew Algernon seems to be holding in what seems to me a most unnecessary manner?
That lady is Miss Cecily Cardew, my ward.
Why am I engaged to be married to Cecily, Aunt Augusta?
I beg your pardon.
Mr. Moncrieff, I'm engaged to be married, Lady Bracknell!
I do not know whether there is something particularly exciting in the air in this part of Hertfordshire, but the number of engagements that go on here seem to me to be above the proper average that statistics have laid down for our guys. I think that perhaps some preliminary inquiry on my behalf would not be out of place. Mr. Worthing, may I ask, is Miss Cardew at all connected with any of the larger railways in London? I merely desire information. Until yesterday, I had no idea that there are any families or persons whose origin was a terminus.
Miss Cardew is the granddaughter of Mr. Thomas Cardew of 149 Belgrave Square, SW, Gervais Park, Dorking, Surrey, and the Sporran, Fifeshire, NB.
That is not unsatisfactory. Three addresses always inspire confidence. Even in tradesmen. But what proof have I of their authenticity?
I have preserved the court guides of the period. They are open to your inspection, Lady Bracknell.
I have known strange errors in their publication.
Ah, but Miss Cardew's family solicitors are Messrs. Markby. Markby. And Markby.
Markby,
yes.
A firm of their very highest position in their profession. Indeed, I'm told that one of the Mr. Markbys is often seen at dinner parties. So far, I'm satisfied.
How extremely kind of you, Lady Bracknell. I have also in my possession, you'll be pleased to hear, certificates of Miss Carter's birth, baptism, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles. Both the German and the English kind.
Ah, a life crowded with incident, I see. Though perhaps somewhat too exciting for such a young girl. I am not myself in favour of premature experiences. Gwendolyn, the time approaches for our departure. We have not a moment to lose.
As a matter of form, Mr. Worthing, I'd better ask if Miss Cardew has any little fortune.
About £130,000 in the funds, that is all. Goodbye, Lady Bracknell, so nice to have seen you.
A moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000. And in the funds. Miss Cardew seems to be a most attractive young lady now that I look at her. Few girls at this present day have any of the really solid qualities. Any of the qualities that last and improve with time. Come here, dear. Pretty child, your dress is sadly simple and your hair seems almost as nature might have left it, but we can soon alter that. A thoroughly experienced French maid can produce a really marvellous result in a very brief space of time. I remember recommending one to young Lady Lansing, and after 3 months, her husband did not know her.
And after 6 months, nobody knew her.
Kindly, cut it down, sweet child. No, the side was what I wanted. Yes, quite as I expected. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile, but the chin a little higher. Style always depends on the way that she is worn. It is worn very high at present. Algernon?
Yes, Aunt Augusta.
There are distinct social possibilities in Miss Cardew's profile.
Cecily is the sweetest, dearest, prettiest girl in the whole world, and I don't care tuppence about social possibilities.
Never be disrespectful of society again, Osmond. Only people that can't get into that. Of course, you know that Algernon has nothing but his debts to pay on. No, I do not believe in mercenary marriages. When I married Lord Brighton, I had no fortune of any kind. But I never dreamt for a moment of letting that stand in my way. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Cecily, you may kiss me.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell.
You may also address me as Aunt Augusta for the future.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
The wedding, I suppose, better take place quite soon.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
I'm not myself in favour of long engagements. It gives people the opportunity of learning one's character before marriage, which... I feel it's never advisable.
Pray, excuse me for interrupting you, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid this engagement cannot go ahead. I am Miss Cardew's guardian, and I cannot give my consent until she comes of age. And that consent, I absolutely decline to give.
Upon what grounds? Algernon is an ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing, but he looks everything. What more from one example?
I apologize for speaking frankly to you, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid I don't approve at all of his moral character. I suspect him of being untruthful.
Untruthful? My nephew Algernon, impossible. He's not Serbian.
I fear there can be no possible doubt about the matter. This afternoon, during my temporary absence in London, on an important question of romance, you obtained admissions to my house under the false pretense of being my brother. Under an assumed name, he drank, I just been informed by my butler, an entire pint bottle of Perrier Jouet Brew 89 wine I was specially reserving for myself. Continuing his disgraceful deception, he succeeded in alienating the affections of my only ward. He subsequently staked a tea and devoured every single muffin. And what makes his conduct all the more heartless is that he knew from the first that I don't have a brother, that I never had a brother, and that I don't intend to have a brother in the future. I distinctly told him so myself yesterday afternoon.
Mr. Worthing, after careful consideration, I've decided entirely to overlook my nephew's conduct to you.
Oh, how very kind, Lady Bracknell. My own decision, however, is unalterable. I decline to give my consent.
Come here, dear. How old are you?
Well, I am only 18. But I always admit to 20 when I go to evening parties.
You are quite right in making some slight alteration. Indeed, no woman should ever be quite so accurate about her age. It looks so calculated. 18, but admitting to 20 at evening parties. Well then, it will not be very long until you are of the age, free from the restraints of tutelage. So I believe that your guardian's consent is, after all, not a matter of any importance.
Excuse me for interrupting you again, Lady Bracknell, but I may tell you that according to her grandfather's will, Miss Cardew does not come of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to be a grave objection to me. 35 is a very attractive age. Indeed, London society is full of women of their very highest birth who have, of their own free choice, remained 35 for years. Lady Dumbleton is an instance in point. She has remained 35 ever since she reached the age of 40. Which was many years ago now. But I don't see why our dear Cecily won't still be all the more attractive at the age you mentioned than she is at the present. There'll be a large accumulation of property.
Archie, could you wait for me till I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You knew I could.
Yes, I felt instinctively. But I can't wait all that time. I ain't waiting for anybody for even 5 minutes. I'm not punctual. I know that. But I do like punctuality in others. And even waiting to be married. It's quite often a question.
Then what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrieff.
Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states positively that she cannot wait till she's 35, a remark which I am bound to say shows a somewhat impatient nature, I beg of you to reconsider your decision.
But, my dear Lady Blackton, the matter is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolyn is the moment that I will let your nephew form an alliance with my ward.
Mr. Worthing, what you propose is quite out of the question.
Then, a passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to.
That is not the destiny I propose for Gwendolyn. Algernon, of course, can choose for himself. Come, then. We have missed 5, if not 6 trains. To miss any more, might expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is quite ready for Christmas.
The christening, sir, isn't that somewhat premature?
Both these gentlemen have expressed a desire for immediate baptism.
They? The idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. Lord Bracknell would be highly displeased if he found that was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
Am I to understand then that there are to be no christenings at all this afternoon?
I don't think that, as things are now, it would be of much practical value to either of us, Dr. Chaswell.
Well, I am grieved to hear such sentiments from you, Mr. Worthing. The same of the heretical views of the Anabaptists, views that I have completely repeated in 4 of my published sermons. However, as your present mood seems to be one peculiarly secular, I will return to the church at once. Indeed, I have just been informed by the pew opener that for the last 1.5 hours, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry.
Oh, Miss Prism! Did I hear you mention Miss Prism?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. I'm on my way to join her.
Pray, allow me to detain you for a moment. This would prove a vital matter of importance to Lord Bracknell and myself. This Miss Prism, is she a female of repellent aspect, remotely connected with education?
She is the most cultivated of ladies and the very picture of respectability.
It is obviously the same person. May I ask what position she holds in your household?
I am a celibate, madam.
Miss Prism, Lady Bracknell, for the last 3 years, has been Miss Cardew's esteemed governess and valued companion.
In spite of what I am told, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
Oh, she approaches. She is nigh.
And I told you I expected to be in the vestry, Jack. I have been waiting for her for 1.75 hours.
Prism! Come here, Prism! Prism! Where is that baby? 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house, number 104, Upper Grosvenor Square, in charge of a perambulator that contained the baby of a male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, at the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered, standing alone in a remote corner of Bayswater. It contained the manuscript of a 3-volume novel of more than usually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there! Prism! Where is that baby?
Lady Brown, I admit with shame that I do not know. I only wish I did. The plain facts of the case are these. On the morning of the day you mentioned, they left us forever branded on my memory. I prepared as usual to take the baby out in his perambulator.
I noticed with me a somewhat all but capacious handbag, in which I had intended to place the manuscript of a work of fiction I had written during my few unoccupied hours. In a moment of mental abstraction, for which I can never forgive myself, I deposited the manuscript in the bassinet, in the baby in the handbag!
But where did you place the handbag?
Do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, I insist on knowing where you placed a handbag that contained that infant.
I left it in one of the large cloakrooms of one of the large railway stations in London.
What railway station?
Victoria. The Brighton Line.
I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolyn, wait here for me.
If you are not too long, Mr. Worthing, I will wait here for you all my life.
What do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I do not even suspect, Dr. Charles. I need hardly tell you that in families of high position, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur. They are hardly considered the thing.
Stranger!
The guy is a very emotional nature.
It sounds as though he was having an argument. I dislike arguments of any kind. They are always vulgar and often convincing.
Oh, they're stopping now.
I wish you would reach some conclusion.
The suspense is terrible. I hope it will last.
Is this a handbag, Miss Prism? Examine it carefully before you speak. The happiness of more than one night depends on your answer.
It seems to be mine. Yes! Here is the injury she received during an upsetting of a gas redundant as an earlier happy days. And here on the lining is a stain caused by an explosion of a temperance beverage. An incident that occurred at Leamington. And here on the initial... on the lock of my initials. I had forgotten in extravagant mood I'd had them placed there. The bag is undoubtedly mine. I'm delighted to have it so unexpectedly restored to me. It's been a great inconvenience being without it all these years.
Miss Prism, more is restored to you than this handbag. I was the baby who raised it!
You?
Yes! Mother!
Mr. Worthing! I am unmarried!
Unmarried?
I do not deny that that is a serious blow.
But who has the right to cast a stone against one who has suffered? A kind of repentance, wiped out an act of folly. Why should there be one law for men and another for women? Mother! I forgive you!
Mr. Worthing, here's some error. There is the lady who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell, I hate to seem inquisitive. But could you kindly inform me who I am?
I'm afraid that the news I have to give you will not altogether please you. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrieff, and consequently, Algernon's elder brother.
Ha 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 ha!
unfortunate brother.
Miss Prism, my unfortunate brother. Gwendolyn, my unfortunate brother. Algy, you young scoundrel. You are going to have to treat me with more respect in the future. You have never treated me like a brother in all your life.
Well, not as a day old boy, I admit. I did my best, however. I was out of practice.
My A1!
But what everyone are you now that you've become someone else?
Good heavens. I quite forgot that one. Your decision on the subject is irrevocable, I suppose.
I never changed, except in my affections. What noble nature you have, Gwendolyn!
Lord Augusta, at the time when Miss Prism, definitely in the handbag, had I been christened?
Every luxury that money could buy, including christening, was lavished upon you by your fond, doting parents. Oh.
Then I was christened! Oh, that is settled. Now, what Christian name was I given? Let me know the words.
Being the eldest son, you were naturally christened after your father.
Yes. Well, what was my father's Christian name?
I cannot, at the present moment, recall what the general's Christian name was. I have no doubt he had one. He was eccentric, I admit, but that was only in later years, and that was the result of the Indian climate, and marriage, and indigestion, and other things of that sort.
Algy, can't you recollect what our father's Christian name was?
I'm afraid we weren't even on speaking terms. He died before I was a year old.
His name would appear in the army list of the period, I suppose, Aunt Augusta.
The general was essentially a man of peace, except for his domestic life. But I have no doubt that his name would appear in any military directory.
The army list of the last 40 years in here. Oh, this book should have been my constant study. Generals. Mellon, Maxbone, Morlin. Oh, what ghastly names they have. Markby, Lixby, Nobbs. Oh, Moncrieff! Lieutenant, 1840. Captain, Lieutenant Colonel. Colonel, General, 1869. Christian names. Ernest John. I always told you my name was Ernest in time. it is Ernest. It naturally is Ernest.
Yes. I remember now that the general was called...
Ernest.
I know I had some particular reason for disliking the name.
Oh, Ernest, my own Ernest. I felt from the start that you could have no other name.
Oh, my own boy. It is a terrible thing for a man to find out suddenly that all his life he's been telling nothing but the truth. Can you forgive me?
I can, for I feel that you are sure to change.
Oh, my own one. Oh, Letitia.
Frederick! At last!
At last.
Gwendolyn, at last.
My nephew, you seem to be displaying signs of triviality.
On the contrary, Aunt Augusta, I have now realized, for the first time in my life, the vital importance of being earnest.